My presentation or my contribution to this conference deals with the Baltic Republics, or more precisely said, with some of their towns and city centers. And it especially centers upon the avoidable demolition of buildings that only had burned down during wartime, but never had been in danger of collapsing. Many such buildings, as I already wrote in my expose, the shells of which had remained in good condition even in 1944, were pulled down some years later. This means at the end of the 1940s, or in some cases around 1955. So why I'm speaking about 1944, maybe one should explain something about the crucial changes in the Baltic region during World War II. However, you probably know that in 1940, the Baltic Republics, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, illegally were made parts of the Soviet Union, and that in 1941, they were invaded by the German Wehrmacht and occupied by the Germans for 3 years until 1944. And that in the second half of the year 1944, Soviet power was re-established so that damages could occur in 1941 when the Wehrmacht started their war against the Soviet Union. Damages could occur in 1944 on the retreat of the Germans, and most likely when the Baltic cities were bombed by the Soviets in 1944. These are the three possibilities of causing damages. So we must ask something about the reason why could destruction continue after the war? Why could it continue? On one hand, this happened by reason of fears that a long-time presence of ruined buildings in central parts of towns might cause doubts among the population whether the efficiency of communism really reaches as far as it was stated by the official propaganda. Communism should seem to be capable to overcome even the consequences of such a horrible war as the one the Soviet Union had had to suffer between 1941 and 1945. By the way, sometimes it is said that this policy, which aimed at getting rid of all ruins in the course of the first 10 years after the war, was a policy that had been applied to the Soviet Union and especially to its new members in the Baltic region, but which was not equally being practiced in the German Democratic Republic's territory. As regards the GDR territory, it seems that a certain number of ruins even has been preserved for a certain time because the Germans should have a guilty conscience, and the presence of some ruins should remind them who had been the ones who had caused the war. However, we see one reason why Baltic cities look like as they do. Communism was supposed to shine in a bright light in the near future. On the other hand, political decision makers themselves tended to be too optimistic whenever they estimated the time and workforce needed to replace damaged buildings by new ones. The interdependence of the two factors resulted in quite contradictory decisions about the preservation or complete destruction of the remnants of historical towns. And even more contradictory was the fact that in some towns, most of the few workers that were at hand had to demolish old structures, whereas almost nothing was done at the same time in order to increase the number of inhabitable flats. As to explain this, I should stress the fact that in 1949 there have been some mass deportations. Many people from the Baltic Republics were deported to Siberia for some years, and of course they were missing on the local stage, and they could not be at the disposal of the local administration whenever it regarded the need for workforce. When they came back and when they had survived, if they had survived, they could come back in 1946. Then life in Baltic cities became rapidly better, because now the number of workforce was more or less sufficient. It had much to do with these deportations. Well, in places where the pre-war architectural heritage had been rather exceptional, the decisions that ruins should disappear were delayed for some years, even until 1960 or 1961. But even there, the final results were the same. So I'm sorry for having made such a complicated paper, but I'm sure I find the the point where it's... Oh yes, there it is. I wanted to tell you something about the different degrees of destructions in Baltic cities, and what we see here, what you have been looking at for some minutes already, is an example of a Baltic city that has been destroyed very much. Most seriously affected by the war were the cities of Narva in the northeast of Estonia, and in Latvia it was Jelgava, which was most affected. And this picture is showing a scenery in Narva. It is a city on the way from Tallinn to Petersburg, situated more closely to Petersburg than to Tallinn, but still in Estonia. It's Estonia's border town towards Russia. What you can see, the only building that has been repaired after the destruction of the town in 1944, the decision was taken to repair and partly to reconstruct the town hall, whereas all the other buildings had to disappear. And now, as a result of this, the town hall is surrounded by these so-called Khrushchevkas. In the slang in the Soviet Union, they were denominated Khrushchevkas, these very simple buildings with very simple flats, because they are all dating back to the area of Nikita Khrushchev. That were the years when they were spread all over the Soviet Union. Interestingly, people were told in that time that these Khrushchevkas would be replaced by nicer buildings as soon as communism would have completely succeeded. But as we know, communism never reached its final goals, and as a consequence of this, the Khrushchevkas have survived. The provisional buildings, they were thought to be provisional, but now they are still a reality. They have survived. This photograph you can see dates back to the year 2010. In the meantime, something has changed in this scenery on the lot southeast to the town hall. There has been erected a new structure bearing a facade of the historical stockhouse, which had been situated on this lot from the 17th century up to 1944. Maybe this is enough about Narva. We have an impression about a Baltic city that had been destroyed quite drastically. An average degree of destruction, more or less, could be found in cities such as Tartu and Pärnu in southern Estonia. And Pärnu will be a town I will return to in a few minutes. Among the centers of the capitals, the old town of Riga suffered somewhat more than the central parts of Tallinn, Estonia's capital, and of Vilnius, Lithuania's capital. And the only large Baltic city, appearance of which did not much change during World War II, is the city of Kaunas, Lithuania's pre-war capital, which in this respect did not share the fate of some central parts of Vilnius and Klaipeda, where the loss of buildings corresponded to the average figures in Lithuania. In the propaganda at that post-war time, in the end of the 1940s mostly, sometimes still in the beginning of the 1950s, many announcements contained the words "to liquidate damages." Yeah, so this is interesting, to liquidate damages, which in fact only meant and was a euphemistic way to express that entire buildings were liquidated. In Estonia, for example, the theaters of Tartu and Pärnu, which had been erected at the beginning of the 20th century, and a number of churches in Pärnu and Narva can be counted among the most prominent examples of such kinds of liquidations. In Latvia, a list of similar cases has to begin with the Black Hat's house in with the Black Hat's house and the city hall in Riga, the remnants of which have been blown up in 1948 and pulled down in 1954, respectively. Here we see what had been visible of the Black Hat's house after the Germans had it caused a partial destruction in 1941 and after the surrounding had been cleaned up. And the question of reconstruction was still vivid at that stage, but as I already told a few sentences ago, the rests that you can see in this picture have been blown up in 1948. The name of the building, by the way, Black Hat's House, sounds a little bit tricky. The Black Hats were a corporation of merchants in medieval times, and it's really a medieval building, and since the Middle Ages it has become more and more marvelous from century and to century, and it had been most magnificent in the 19th and 20th century, so that it was quite a loss for the city that it first was damaged and then blown up. So that the question of reconstruction has never been forgotten. And after the changes of 1991, the construction could start. And it started rather quickly, because in the year 2001, Riga could celebrate its 800th anniversary as a city, and there was much reason to celebrate this anniversary in a broad framework, because it's not only an anniversary founded on the first mentioning, but we can find historical records that give evidence that this city of Riga really came into existence in 1201, so things are quite sure, and therefore it was quite sure that the city should shine again, and therefore the reconstruction was realized, and as you see nowadays the reconstructed building can be very useful to fill the cover of books and things like that. What's that? Oh, I took the wrong button. Okay, that's right. Because I wanted to say something in addition about the Church of St. Peter's. St. Peter's Church was already visible in the background on the picture before. You see what was left of the church in the result of the World War, and that it has been completed again. And this happened contradictory to what I said about the Black Hat's house during Soviet time. This completion of the steeple with its high spire was made during Soviet time. And by the way, it made a strong argument for the promoters of the reconstruction of the Black Hat's house, because it's clear on the basis of what Arnold told us that the idea to reconstruct the Black Hat's house in the 1990s also met criticism. And those who formulated this criticism could be told that they should allow the Black Hat's house to reappear, because they also allowed the church to be completed by its spire. And the argument was, if a church can be completed with its spire, and everyone agrees with that, then it must also be tolerable that a whole old town, which is monument in itself, is completed by an important building. That was the argument. But now I should continue by saying something about this rather small town of Pärnu, where an important church has not survived, and one has to ask why. This town of Pärnu is situated between Riga and Tallinn. It's a little bit closer, little bit less distant from Tallinn, but generally spoken, one can say that the distances to the capital in the north, Tallinn, and the capital in the south, Riga, is similar. It's a town about today, 55,000 inhabitants, and closely to situated closely to the Baltic Sea, so that it developed as a resort town since the 19th century. In the medieval times, it has been a member of the Hanseatic League, just as Riga and Tallinn have been, and as such it possessed also this old church, which was an architectural monument which not any town possesses And in the very beginning of the post-war time, no one thought about blowing up the rests of this church. The first plans that were made for Pärnu were rather careful. But things changed around 1950 in a very radical way, and there are two or three reasons why this could happen. One was that around 1950, the personnel of committees of various kinds changed so often that anyone belonging to such a committee obviously thought the more radical my ideas about doing away with traditions and monuments are, the more certainty there may be that my job will still be my job next year. This was one crucial reason. The other one is yesterday I became witness when you and Max discussed about the question whether there's much difference in a typical Western German town dependent on whether it had a local government dominated by the Social Democratic Party or a local government dominated by conservative parties. And in the case of the Baltic cities, it would have been nice if there would have been any local government with authority over the further planning for the town. The planning was made by centralized authorities, in this case in Tallinn, in the capital of the Estonian Republic. And therefore, knowledge about local circumstances lacked, and some responsibilities on the same time were left on the local level. And maybe it was a very bad precondition for this church that the decision what buildings are historical monuments left on the local decision-making level. Then a third reason is that in the early times of the Soviet Union there were several changes in the ideas how to divide the territory in terms of administration. There was 1 year in the course of which the thought was pursued to divide the Estonian Republic into three oblasts. You know the word oblast in the context of Kaliningrad. Today it is still vivid in this context, but in other contexts it is nearly forgotten. In Estonia as well, but there was 1 year, 1952, when the idea was pursued to divide the Estonian Republic into three oblasts. And then Pärnu would have been the center of one of these districts called oblast, and would have had need of huge buildings for administration. A year later, the idea was thrown away, but in consequence, the year 1952 was a lost year in terms of the attempt to make Pärnu town or space with qualities that make it inhabitable again. It was a completely lost year in this sense. So finally, the rests of the church, to make it short, were blown up in 1954, and that's it. The church cannot be reconstructed nowadays because it's too expensive. And in this context, I may be allowed to give a second example of a town which has lost its churches. It's the town of Klaipėda in western Lithuania, which is also a town with a silhouette without churches, and the local population is mything these spires and dreams of reconstructing at least one of them. The church that has been lost by blowing up its rests in Klaipėda is not as valuable as this St. Nicholas church in Pärnu has been. And nevertheless, the local inhabitants of Klaipėda today are so convinced that the church should reappear that they have placed memorial stone with an inscription that is saying that the reconstruction has symbolically begun. There's no money no perspective to get the money, but the reconstruction has symbolically begun. So, okay. I see I've 5 minutes left. That's a good idea to make it like this, because then I may be allowed to make some final remarks on things that are a little bit different to what I said in the course of the last minutes. And let me say, as someone who published such a book, as I showed you, about the history of Riga, I would like to end this presentation by making some remarks on challenges inherent to producing the narrative of such a book, because these remarks can be brought in a close connection to what our conference is dealing with. Trying to summarize the history of a city such as Riga in a book which should not comprise more than 300 pages, more or less, to comprise such a book mainly means that many facts inevitably will have to be omitted. Consequently, decisions have to be taken concerning the abstract principles which may legitimatize the shortness or even absence of chapters about certain historical phenomena or developments. One such principle can be generated, for example, by saying that distinctions between urban history and national history should be made as far and as clearly as it seems to be possible. If a survey of the history of a town is strictly based upon this principle, it will contain elements of national history only to a degree that appears absolutely necessary in order to explain the causes of events constituting the history of the town itself. And similarly, one can discover a tendency in such books, which may typical of them, of any kind of survey of urban history, whenever it includes times of war. If this is the case, that it includes times of war, mostly a lot of details can be read about the years of that war, whereas the years after the war has ended are nearly neglected. One may indeed be inclined to think that this is done in order to economize pages after having had the need for so many pages for the war itself. Words such as starvation or vandalism, all these typical phenomena of post-war years, mentioned once, and that is all. So maybe it would be interesting to examine whether there are any interdependencies between the degree of destruction of a respective town and the percentage of pages dealing with post-war periods within a book that summarizes the history of that town. My supposition is that in the case of small towns, this percentage is much greater than in the case of capitals, with their broader scale of events constituting urban history. So the topics of this presentation, and probably of various presentations during this conference, can be seen as an attempt to emphasize post-war years instead of neglecting them, and as to stay aware of what I said in the sentence before, and how I drew up this presentation. This presentation, as I should say once more, did concentrate not merely on the capitals, but referred to smaller towns as well. And that was the intention. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for your attention.